Moving on from channel proteins, let's talk about carrier proteins. They can help transport ions and other things, sugars, amino acids. But carrier proteins do require a concentration difference across the membrane, and they bind to the molecule that they are transporting. So these, unlike ion channels, these could be saturated because you could only have facilitated diffusion of molecules with carrier proteins that depend upon the number of transporters available. If the number of transporters are saturated, then that limits the rate at which this type of facilitated diffusion can occur. So here's an example of facilitated diffusion brought about by carrier proteins. High concentration outside, low in, binds to the extracellular side, is somehow transported. We're not going into mechanism here, to the inside of the intracellular domain and where it is released. So this is an example of a carrier protein. No energy is being put into this, simply the thermodynamic force of a molecule wanting, thermodynamically speaking, to flow down its concentration gradient is the only force that is required here. No input of energy by the cell is required in this case. Now let's move on to the special case of passive transport that involves the transport of water passively. And this brings up the whole concept of osmosis, which describes the ability of water to flow from high concentrations of water to low concentrations of water across a semi-permeable membrane. Because cells exist in an aqueous solution at an environment, and their cytoplasm is an aqueous solution. Water we refer to as the solvent, and then the dissolved substances are the solutes in water. And that's true for external cellular environments, but also the cytoplasm as well. Water is the solvent, and dissolved substances are the solutes. And what osmosis is then is a diffusion of water across a membrane that is permeable to water toward a higher solute concentration. And the best way to look at this is that actually water is moving from a high concentration of water molecules to a lower concentration of water molecules. And so let's look at that. Consider this case. We have a semi-permeable membrane, and the solute here is urea. That's an organic molecule. And in this part of our tube, we have a higher concentration of urea than we have over here. Another way to look at it is that in terms of water concentration, the water concentration is higher on the right than on the left, because here the solute concentration is higher. Here the solvent concentration is higher. And since the semi-permeable membrane is not permeable to urea, that is, urea can't move from its region of high concentration to a region of low concentration, but the membrane is permeable to water, water will flow from right to left because water is moving from a region of high concentration to a region of lower concentration with respect to water molecules. So, another way of looking at this is that because we have a solute molecules here, the urea, water will form shells through polar interactions with the polar solute. And those water molecules are no longer free to diffuse across the semipermeable membrane. So the net concentration of free water here is lower, and that's what drives this osmotic flow of water across the semipermeable membrane. Now, if two solutions have different osmotic concentrations of solute, we refer to them in two ways. A hypertonic solution has a higher solute concentration relative to another solution, whereas a hypotonic solution has a lower solute concentration. And if two solutions have the same osmotic concentration, then we say that they are isotonic. So we have hypertonic, higher dissolved molecules, higher solutes, higher solute concentration, hypotonic, lower solute concentration relative to another solution, and equal, if you have two solutions with equal solute concentrations, we say they are isotonic. Now, water in cells flows across membranes, but mainly through special proteins called aquaporins that allow water to pass through the membrane. So usually plasma membranes and other membranes tend to be semi-permeable to water because of the existence of aquaporin proteins that allow water to flow across those membranes. Let's refer to osmotic pressure briefly here. Osmotic pressure is the force needed to stop the flow of water through osmosis. So if you put a cell in a hypotonic solution, it will gain water. Why will it gain water? Because there's a higher concentration of solute inside the cell than in the hypotonic solution outside it. And that means there's a higher water concentration, if you will, outside the cell than inside the cell. So water will flow into the swell, into the cell. And that creates pressure on the cell. As water flows in, the cell needs to expand. That creates pressure. And if the membrane that's surrounding the cell is strong enough, then you reach a counterbalance of osmotic pressure driving water in with a hydrostatic pressure driving water out. And the organisms that have cell walls have very strong coverings, as you know. Those cell walls are rigid, and so they are able to withstand the osmotic, if they're placed in a hypotonic solution, they're able to withstand the osmotic pressure by counterbalancing with the hydrostatic pressure. But animal cells are in trouble if they are in placed in a too hypotonic solution. So they will swell, and animal cells can burst if they are placed in a hypotonic solution. So animal cells tend to be in normal circumstances, organisms create isotonic environments for animal cells. Let's look at this in the case of red blood cells. You can do an experiment where you put red blood cells in a hypotonic solution, or I'm sorry, hypertonic solution in this case. Let's start out over here, hypotonic solution. If you put cells in a hypotonic solution, they will swell because water will flow in down its concentration gradient. There will be a higher concentration of water outside the cell than inside the cell. Water will flow into the cell because the membrane is semi-permeable to water, and cells can swell and then even burst. In an isotonic solution, there's the net flow of water in is equal to the net flow of water out because the solute concentration inside the cell is the same as outside. But in a hypertonic solution, place cells in a very salty solution that contains greater concentrations of solute than inside the cytoplasm. Well, then water will leave the cell because in the hypertonic solution, the concentration of water in the solution is less than the concentration of water in the cell. And so water will flow out of the cell and cells will shrink and shrivel. And this is a shriveled red blood cell in a hypertonic solution, a normal cell, red blood cell, in a isotonic solution. And here is a cell swelling, a red blood cell swelling in a hypotonic solution. Now in plant cells, in a hypertonic solution, the cell will shrink away from the cell wall. In an isotonic solution, everything's fine. And in a hypotonic solution, the cell swells, but there's a turgidity that exists. As the cell swells, it runs up to the cell wall, and it's prevented from bursting in those cases. Now, organisms use strategies to maintain osmotic balances. Some cells use extrusion. They actually have a contractile vacuole that squeezes water out of the cell. Marine organisms tend to adjust their internal concentration to match seawater, some of them, not all of them. And terrestrial animals need to circulate an isotonic fluid over their cells. So your blood, for example, has solutes in it, like albumin, the protein albumin, that maintains blood in an isotonic state relative to the cytoplasm inside cells. And plant cells use this turgor pressure to push the cell membrane against the cell wall, and that keeps the cell rigid. Now we're ready to move on to active transport. And thus far, we've been considering passive transport, both in the case of water, when we look at osmotic flow, and also we've looked at the passive transport driven by the flow of substances across a membrane down their concentration gradients, where no net input of energy was required. However, in active transport, we are moving substances from a low concentration to a high concentration. And this is thermodynamically unfavorable and requires the input of energy derived from the energy currency molecule of the cell, ATP. And that can be used either directly or indirectly, as we will see, to fuel the active transport. Active transport requires very highly selective carrier proteins to conduct the transport. So the carrier proteins in active transport include several classes. One are uniporters. They move one molecule at a time, meaning only one molecule is moved, one type of molecule is moved by the selective uniporters. Symporters are selective for two molecules in the same direction. They're capable of moving two molecules in the same direction, and we'll see how in a moment. Whereas antiporters move two molecules in opposite directions. Symporters, same directions. Uniporters use one molecule, move one molecule at a time, and antiporters move molecules in two molecules in opposite directions. And you can describe facilitated diffusion carriers in the same way at uniporters, symporters, or antiporters. But in the case of facilitated diffusion, you're talking about passive transport. So let's look at an active transport case that is the sodium-potassium pump. And this the sodium-potassium pump uses ATP directly to fuel its active transport. The breakage of high-energy phosphate bonds in ATP provide energy for driving active transport. And the antiporter that is the sodium-potassium pump moves three sodiums out of the cell and two potassiums into the cell. For every three sodiums that are pumped out of the cell, two potassiums are pumped into the cell. And both are moved against their concentration gradients. And the ATP energy that's used here is the cleavage of high-energy phosphate bonds in ATP is used to change the shape of the carrier protein, that is the pump, the sodium-potassium pump, in order to allow this pumping of sodium out of the cell and the pumping of potassium into the cell. And we will see how the affinity of the carrier protein is changed by the conformational changes that are driven by ATP. So let's go through this process. So here's the sodium-potassium pump. Sodium will be bound by the pump protein, and three sodiums are bound. At that point, ATP is hydrolyzed and phosphorylates the pump protein, and ATP is released. That phosphorylation induces a conformational change in the protein, which now allows the bound sodium to escape into the extracellular space, where it is at a higher concentration than inside the cell. So this is against its concentration gradient, using the energy provided by ATP hydrolysis. In this state, the open state towards extracellular space, two potassium ions combine, and when they bind, that causes the release of the phosphate that was attached to the protein by ATP hydrolysis, and this returns to its original state where it's open to sodium. And when it does that, potassium is released inside the cell. And now we'll consider other active transport proteins.